But here, I don't want the deer to have any paths. What I'm trying to do is get them to stop and turn. I want them to walk along one property line, and as they get to the corner, I want them to turn and then walk down the other property line to keep the deer on the property as long as possible. So you can see in the background, I've got a lot of hinge cuts, and it's kind of an entangled mess. There's no paths through that corner. And we're going to be heading in this direction. You can see it's pretty messy here, pretty thick. And as we walk over here, it thins out. So as they're walking down the property line, they're coming from that, from the direction that we're going to be walking in. I'm pointing the camera in that direction right now. Bring this down a little bit more. When they hit this little open pocket here, I want them to turn and then walk that way. And I've done a little bit of work down that line, but not as extensive as what I'm about to show. And I put this maple down here, and I didn't think it was going to live, and I was going to cut it and put it on the ground. I hinge cut it. And it's such a sharp angle right here. No way it's going to live, but it's live. So we'll leave it here because it's browse. When it finally dies, I'm just going to drop it on the ground because I want this to be a pocket here. And now we're going to start to leave corridors so they can walk into the neighbor's property. But all along here, I don't want them to funnel into one path. Here's a hinge cut that's alive. So we look back on our tracks, you can see how as I veer off to the left over there, there's a pocket right there, and that's where I want them to turn and walk down the other property line. I don't want them to get into the corner. I mean, they will, but what we're talking about is cruising bucks, looking for does. We want them to be cruising through here, hit that corner and turn. I've got to stand down along that property line. And the main stand is going to be, we're heading towards it now, but it's quite distance away. I don't want to come out here and hunt this and leave my scent here. So I don't have any stands right here. And this is the corner, and this again, I think, is going to be the buck bedding. Oh, look at, pleated woodpeckers have been busy. It looks like that cedar. Our white birch is dead. I got a really large white birch right there, like that one. That's canoe grade. So you can see I've got a path going through there. And this is the main path here going along the property line. I got a path that goes in through there. I left that tree up because it's actually living. Another hinge cut for browse. We've got a couple of paths walking through here. And this is where I'm sharing the deer with the neighbor. They can walk through here all they want. Now I've got paths all the way through this thicket of tag elders that we're about to walk through. There's a maze of paths. Here's another pocket where it's open. Now on a south wind, I imagine them, they're going to be bending down in here and looking this way. And I've got multiple paths for them to run into. Escape. I got paths all the way through all of that. Those are tag elders that are bent down because of real heavy wet snow a year ago December. Oh, look, we got a rub right here that I haven't noticed before, and a spruce right there. That's what we like to see. I like to see 100 of those back here. But I got main paths walking all through here. That makes sense. There's a rub here, so this is one of the paths. There's two or three more that go in this direction. And there's one or two that go in the opposite direction, but I dead-end them in my main path here. I want my paths to be parallel with the border so that they stay on it. You can see there's one that goes in that direction. This is the main one that I cut through it. And it snowed very recently, like that yesterday or the night before yesterday. You can see there's one deer here that used it in that time frame. There's all kinds of escape paths in here. Here's another pocket where it opens up. This is normally pretty wet, so this area here is kind of up out of the wetness and they can bed down in here. I cleared off the branches so they can see around here, and that makes it a nice pocket. Get that iris on here and brighten her up again. Simple function. Here's something that I hadn't thought about before. I should clear those branches out, and then this will be another potential bed for them. We're still working our way through this tag elder thicket, and this was made back in probably 99 or 2000. There's a lot of black ash here, and I just dropped them on the ground. It was wide open. You could see through from here 150 yards. So I dropped them all down, and these tag elders grew up and created some real nice thicket here for them to hide in, walk through. I used to have a stand on that cedar tree right there, and I actually shot a buck out of it. It wasn't huge, but I've seen a lot of deer hunting that, and I don't want to hunt it anymore. If I ever did want to put a stand in here, I'll only hunt it when I know it's going to rain and wash my scent away. So again, we're walking through the main path. Look at all the cedar branches that fell in here. Cedar leaves. It's like a feast waiting to happen for the deer. Now again, I got quite a few paths that work through these windfalls. We're working into a long corridor of rather mature white cedar, and the deer really like to eat white cedar. And again, you got the property line right there where there's no trees, and the big trees are the property line. These big trees are on my land here. So this corridor of cedar is probably 100 yards wide and 200-300 yards long, almost the entire length of the property, and it's parallels the property line border, but we're a good 100 yards from the line in that direction now. You can see I put some trees down over here, create some thickets. We're on the track of the deer here. But I've had multiple beds in right in this area. I'm guessing it's on a south wind. And that's the wind that I hunted, because that's the right wind to come into camp. But here we got these hinge cuts and these trees that I just fell on the ground and made a little bit of a tangled mess here. And I've seen beds right here where they're probably watching that way where it's open and smelling what's behind this little tangle that I created. Now I'm going to come in here and kind of clean it up a little bit and put down a couple of cedars over it in a couple of years, but a lot of these trees are alive yet. And if they're alive, then I want to leave them alone, because they're producing browse. So we're coming up to another tangle that I produced. And there are lanes going parallel with the property line on both sides of this tangle of trees. And again, a lot of these are still alive yet. When they die, I'm going to just put them on the ground, segment them out. So you can see there's a path where the hinge cuts are, and that's the main path. That's where I want them to be walking, right along there. But I've got some little secondary paths closer to the borderline. Let's go find the one that's over here. Again, I would consider this a pocket where it's open here with the cedars. This is a large pocket. I'll probably do some more work on it. Oh, here's an old stand of mine. Geez, I still got some tree steps up there. That was back when I wasn't so aware of the noise I was making. Right here is a path right along the border. See, there's a lot of windfalls on this direction, and over here is where I cut trees. Again, I want to make that maze and pocket effect. So this is the maze, and now we're opening up to a pocket. This is kind of a junction of different paths. Again, I want them to get over there, but if they walk on this path, it's okay too, because they're going to go end up in the same spot where my stand is going to be. So again, I'm not trying to block the deer to put going on the neighbors anywhere around here. They can, you know, I want them to look like they have escape routes. They aren't going to want to go there if they're under pressure, because it's wide open. So I believe they'll stay here. The odds are they'll stay in this maze and pockets here. See, I did a lot of work in here. This is where I want them to begin to funnel into the main path. So the main path is just over in that direction, 20, 25 yards. This is a little secondary path, and they're using it. Let's see tracks. Here's a maple that was hinge cut, and it's actually, maybe it died. So if this one died, I'll probably put it on the ground. Cut that 3 years ago. I started this, well, actually 2.5 years ago. This is my third winter. I've been working in here for probably 6-7 days worth of habitat work this year. Okay, turn this down again. Let's just put it on manual, see what happens. That's not too bad. So that cedars are windfalling, and I'm not excited to go harvest them or anything. So right here we got a little bit of a pocket, and I put down a lot of garbage ash trees all along here, and I'm thinking if there's a south wind, they're going to want to be bedding in this pocket right here. I haven't seen a lot of beds right in this spot, but there's a lot of beds on a consistent basis, just a little bit coming up on them. Here's a hinge cut I did that hung up. I just leave it there. But there's a trail that goes between, I cut a segment out of a big cedar that fell down in there. I cut a segment out of there. There's another path over there. That's me. So there's three paths that we're looking at right here that head in that direction. That's where the looking branch is in the mock scrape. We have another pocket over here on a south wind. I'm thinking they're going to be bedding in here too.